Good evening and welcome to the second lecture, the second of the IWM lectures by Professor Rosa Brooks. I'm just going to introduce her very briefly today for those of you who weren't with us yesterday. For those who were there, they will just have to bear with me for a moment. Rosa Brooks is a professor of law at the Georgetown University Law Center, but she was also an anthropologist in a previous birth. She studied anthropology at Oxford before she moved on to law. She's been a consultant to Human Rights Watch, but she's also served as counselor to the Undersecretary of Defense for Policy. She's been senior advisor at the US Department of State and is well known as a journalist and a columnist for foreign policy, as well as a senior fellow at the New America Foundation. So Rose has had a many-faceted career dealing, however, with questions of international law, national security, and war, the topic that she's chosen for the three IWM lectures. Today's lecture was titled War Bursts Its Boundaries, Counting the Costs. And when I asked her if that's going to be exactly the topic that she's dealing with, she said, what I'll say could also fit under that title. She's going to recap yesterday's lecture for those of you who weren't there last night, very briefly. Let me just pick up 3 points from what I recall were some of the really fascinating insights we got from you yesterday, and I hope you'll be developing some of these themes today. The whole question of drone warfare, and how you showed for me very, very convincingly how the development of drone warfare has put under strain the distinction between political killings, revenge, killing in self-defense, and military action by blurring the binary boundary between war and not war. So this, I thought, is something which is going to concern you today. But when I heard you talking about it, I also, what I found fascinating was it reminded me of President Obama's remark that drones would scale the solution to the problem because they would enable the United States to kill the people who are trying to kill us, as he put it. But what you showed yesterday was even if it were to do so, even if it were to scale the solution to the problem, it would still leave open a host of moral, legal, political, and technological issues, which you disentangled in such fascinating detail. So these are not just questions of legitimacy of drone welfare, which is being questioned by many. But what you also showed that was, I think, that there is a signal departure which drone warfare shows us, a departure from the impersonal destruction that we usually associate with modern warfare, in that here is personally targeted killing. And the question that you left open, but which I hope we can get to discussing today, does it make a moral difference if it is personally targeted killing or impersonal warfare? And being an anthropologist myself, the story I was reminded of while listening to you there was Ronaldo Rosaldo's very famous story when he was doing field work among the Ilonggot in the Philippines, who were actually quite brutal about killing their enemies. They were known actually as even cannibals and headhunters. And while he was doing field work there, his letter for the draft, the Vietnam War conscription, arrives. And he was, you know, trying to not go back to the US to be conscripted into the Vietnam War. And this whole moral dilemma of conscription, non-conscription didn't interest the Ilonggot at all. What interested them was only the question, so if you go to war, whom will you kill, Rosaldo? And when they found out that he would be killing strangers, they said, this is not understandable. It's absolutely immoral to be killing strangers. We only kill people whom we know well, our neighbors. And this started a whole conversation between who are legitimate targets of violence and what does it mean to think in terms other than the categories of war that we are used to thinking about. The very, very tantalizing references which you made yesterday to bioengineered weapons, I look forward to hearing about these. And of course, when you finished your lecture, I asked myself the question, the boundaries that you were discussing, or the fuzziness of the boundaries between war and not war, seemed to me also a question about the shift of boundaries to within the nation state, not only when we're talking about civil war, as we discussed yesterday in the Q&A, but also the whole question of what is it to have a state of exception, because states of exception move the boundaries within the nation state and also are about the infringement of rights, about very much the same kinds of legal and political ethical questions which you are raising with regard to transformations in the nature of war. So those were the kinds of issues I was left with after listening to your talk yesterday, and I hope we'll have a chance to hear you further on some of these today. And then we have a rest tomorrow, and we take up a final a discussion with you day after in the evening. So welcome back, and you have the word.
Thank you, Shalini. Well, thank you. Thank you all for being here today. And for those of you who were here yesterday, I'm slightly less jet-lagged today, so hopefully everything will become clear. I'm going to recap a little bit from yesterday's lecture, because I know that some of you were not here, then move in to talk about some of the around-the-corner technologies that are further transforming war. So yesterday I spoke about the ways in which human societies have long sought to police the lines between what we consider to be war and what we consider to be not war. And different societies have drawn those lines in different places, and as Shalini said, made sense of what counts as war in very different ways, and the rules associated with war and warfare and warriors in very different ways. But virtually all have sought to draw some kind of sharp line, because obviously the behaviors that we take for granted as acceptable in wartime, most notably killing, are behaviors that by and large during peacetime we consider reprehensible and criminal. So at various different societies at different points in time have used different kinds of rituals to demarcate that line between war and not war. They used war drums and war songs, masks of predatory animals, war paint, various initiation rituals, abstinence, special drinks, special drugs that you take, both to prepare individual warriors, usually male but not exclusively, for war, to prepare men to assume their warrior identity, and then again to prepare and enable warriors to transition back again to ordinary life. And although different societies have drawn these lines in different places in different ways using different rituals, the reason every society has tried to draw them in one way or another has been to try to preserve that notion that war is the temporary exception from the norm. Not war is the norm, war is the exception. Behaviors that are unacceptable in times of peace are acceptable, expected in times of war, but the brutality that is permitted and even applauded in times of war is a type of brutality that is often literally conceptualized as toxic to ordinary community life, as a poison in ordinary community life. We still have such rituals in today's modern world, and this is reaching back into my very distant anthropological studies in my own past, but obviously when you think of the ways in which new recruits in many Western militaries are still treated, we still put them through types of initiation rituals that would be very familiar to any of these so-called primitive tribes studied by 19th century anthropologists, which is to say their hair is shorn, we rip them away from their families and their civilian environments, we take away their garments, we force them to communicate using a new language, the familiar phrases of everyday language don't suffice anymore, you have to use new terms, we exhaust them, we deprive them of sleep. And then as they transition into their warrior selves, and certainly I'm less familiar with European militaries, but certainly the United States military where I come from, if you ever look at the patches worn by military personnel that indicate what unit they're in, also would be very, very familiar to any anthropologist. They're eagles and tigers and dragons, sharks, other types of predators. Weapons are named after predatory animals and so forth. So there, too, the warrior identity is very specifically and deliberately inculcated. But in our own modern societies, we also have elaborate rules for warfare, which today we call law. We call the law of armed conflict, essentially, the international law of armed conflict. And these are, again, just as ritualized and formalistic and magical, if you will, in some ways, as any thinking of any other society at any time in history. Think of the Third Geneva Convention's rules on who is eligible to be granted the full protections of a prisoner of war. And the list, of course, as many of you probably already know, if you are to be eligible for the protections of the Third Geneva Convention as a POW, you need to be commanded by a person responsible for his subordinates, which is to say that you need to be part of a hierarchical organization. You need to have a fixed distinctive sign recognizable at a difference, which we usually interpret as you need to wear a uniform. You don't count if you're not wearing a uniform. You need to carry your arms openly, both a chivalric tradition and a way to distinguish between who is a warrior, who is not a warrior. And you need, of course, to conduct your operations in accordance with the laws and customs of war. So we want to conceptualize ourselves war as a limited rule-bound activity that you transition out of ordinary society and your ordinary identity into a warrior self-identity. You qualify to maintain your warrior status by adhering to certain ritualized norms and rules, and you must conduct yourself always in accordance to those, or else you cease to have those. You cease to have the privileges, and in the legal terms, you cease to be a privileged combatant. You become what the Bush administration used to variously term an unlawful combatant and so forth, which didn't really make any sense, but that's another story. But you lose your privileges as a warrior if you break the rules that we have set. On the other hand, if you abide by the rules, you wear your uniform, you carry your arms openly, you're part of an organized military and so forth, you receive certain privileges. Not only if you're captured, you're entitled, legally speaking, to certain rights, which range from the most basic human rights all the way up to elaborate rules for how often you receive mail, whether you're entitled to play soccer and so forth, football. But also the other enormous privilege that you receive if you follow the rules is that your acts that would be criminal were you not a warrior in time of war are immunized. You have what we call law combatant immunity. You will not be prosecuted. So as I said yesterday, when there's no armed conflict, killing is a crime. You murder another person, there are a limited number of defenses, but they're defenses only. It's not excused up front if you murder someone. You know, you may be able to successfully plead self-defense or something like that, but essentially it's a crime. Whereas obviously in an armed conflict, combatants can kill an enemy combatant, or for that matter, a civilian taking direct part in hostilities, or a civilian who's just in the way, as long as what you do is consistent with various other rules relating to proportionality, necessity, and so forth. And you won't be prosecuted, provided you follow the rules. And in fact, you may be praised. You may get more little ritualistic things, little ribbons that you can put on your chest, colorful ribbons and little pieces of metal with more predatory animals on them and so forth. The same is true for other types of what we would normally consider to be very bad behavior. The destruction of property, the censoring, monitoring, and surveillance, infringements on privacy of ordinary people, lawful in wartime under most circumstances. They're oversimplifying complex set of rules. Generally speaking, in peacetime, if the state wants to spy on you or abridge your freedoms or listen in on your communications or read your email, your letters, it has to go through all sorts of legal hoops. But in the context of an armed conflict, those rules are loosened. And the same is true, of course, of detention. If the state wants to lock you up and is not interested in charging you or giving you an attorney, in peacetime, we would consider that a grave abuse, a grave human rights abuse. In the context of an armed conflict, it's acceptable to detain both enemy combatants and civilians, enemy civilians who are participating in one way or another in the war effort, and to keep them detained without charging them, because you, as long as they have followed the rules, they haven't committed a crime, they themselves have immunity from prosecution if they're combatants behaving in lawful ways, but you can certainly lock them up for the duration of the conflict. This is, of course, also premised on the idea that conflicts do have ends, that they will end, that they don't go on forever. And we accept these, let me just add that this, I've been talking about international law and the law of armed conflict, but most domestic jurisdictions similarly differ in the degree to which we expect states to jump through legal hoops to give people due process and so forth, depending on whether or not there is an armed conflict of war or claims about warlike threats. Certainly true in the United States. I know it's true in the UK. It's been increasingly true in France, many other states as well, that we assume that when there is a war or a threat, domestic courts as well as international law grants the state much more leeway to use its mechanisms of coercion and control and to sometimes formally suspend ordinary rights, sometimes to declare states of emergency, and sometimes courts just say, well, even in the absence of some sort of declared state of exception, we're willing to give the state far more latitude. And we tolerate, by and large, much looser constraints on state power. We tolerate things that ordinarily we would consider to be abusive behavior by the state and the state's agents during times of war, precisely because we view war as an exception. We view war as bounded and exceptional, a temporary state of affairs that is distinct from ordinary life. So there may be lots of things that if you said, this is going to go on forever and ever and ever, the state's going to be able to listen to everything you say electronically, forever and ever, the state's going to be able to lock up anybody without charge, without making public the evidence or giving you an opportunity to confront that evidence against you. Forever and ever, the state's going to be able to kill those it designates as enemies without having to offer an explanation in a judicial setting ever. We would say, whoa, that's terrible. We don't want to live in that sort of society. But in the context of armed conflicts, we are generally willing to accept it because we usually think, again, if we think of armed conflicts, wars, as bounded. We think of them as bounded in space. We think there is a battlefield over here, but not over here. This state is neutral. This state is part of an armed conflict. So these rules, these much more permissive rules about state use of coercion, apply here, but not here. We think of them, as I said, as having a beginning and an end. So we think, okay, you know, the state can lock people up and detain them during the armed conflict. But when it's over, they have to let them go, which is fine when you presume that even if we don't know the precise date at which the war will be over, that it will be over at some point, maybe in 2 years, maybe in five, maybe even in 10, but eventually it will be over. It's not going to go on forever. And we also accept these because we presume that the distinctions between warriors and non-warriors are reasonably clear, that it is the warriors, those who participate in the war, whether they are formally part of an army, state's military forces, or part of an insurgent group or a terrorist group, that if they're participating in the war, they can be acted upon in these ways, but we can tell the difference between those people and the civilians who have to be left alone and whose rights still have to be respected. But as we also discussed yesterday, law always lags behind reality. Law is always an effort to constrain and control a messy reality that it's always trying to catch up with. And today, in many ways, we're beginning to see the elaborate legal and institutional structures that we have designed to contain war, tame war, and constrain state power are beginning to fit very poorly with more and more kinds of emerging conflicts, emerging actors, emerging behaviors. So the traditional understanding of war, and I said yesterday one of the odd gaps in the international law of armed conflict is that it does not actually offer a universally accepted definition of armed conflict. So we know this body of rules applies in armed conflicts, but we're never quite told, well, exactly how do we know when there's an armed conflict? This has been the subject of much rumination, and a number of courts have tried to think it through, but essentially people tend to come down and, well, all right, an armed conflict, it must, first of all, it's gotta be violent. This is fairly obvious. It has to have dead bodies, or it's not an armed conflict. If there's no physical force involved, it's not a war. It has to be widespread. It's not just one person shoots another in a border skirmish. It has to be involve lots of people. It has to have a political objective. It's not just a brawl that breaks out and everybody's fighting for the sake of fighting and then it's over. It has to be organized. It's not a barroom brawl or a riot. It's something that is organized. And today, there are plenty of wars like this. There are plenty of wars that fit right into that knee category. If you look at Syria, if you look at Congo or the conflicts in the Sudan, they still look like what we think of as war. There are lots and lots of dead bodies and lots of bloodshed, and we know where they are and we know where they aren't. And there are problems on the margins, right, in terms of our legal understanding of these things. But if you're a lawyer and you're not that interested in, as we lawyers say, well, we're these are nice. These are nice wars that fit very neatly into our legal categories. They may be utterly awful and tragic for all concerned. There may be violations of the rules of armed conflict being committed by many sides, many parties. But they look familiar to us. They look like the paradigm of war that our legal structures and institutions were designed to attempt to control, not always successfully, but they still look pretty familiar to us. And obviously, there's since the emergence of the law of armed conflict, which is really a very recent invention, essentially the last century and a half or so, there have always been problems on the margins with the sort of nice, tidy framework of wars bounded in space and time and so forth. There have always been guerrillas and partisans and civilians who participate in unclear ways, revolving door kinds of participation in hostilities and so forth. So there have always been questions on the margins. But by and large, most conflicts, until relatively recently, have not, from the perspective of a lawyer, presented too many puzzles. And there, as I said, there are still many wars today that look pretty familiar. But today, those more traditional, old-fashioned kind of wars, if you will, good old-fashioned wars, are increasingly coexisting with types of conflict that do not fit at all well into that old paradigm of what a war is and how it is bounded and so forth. And the most obvious example, but not the only example, is the U.S. war on terrorism. And I'm going to talk a bit about that specifically in the context of drone strikes, but I do want to say before I even get into that, that although I think it's tempting to see this as, well, that's just the U.S. doing bad stuff, and to some extent it is just the U.S. doing bad stuff, but it's not only the U.S. doing bad stuff, it's also the U.S. responding to some real changes, and it is also some real changes in terms of technologies that are going to have a further transformative effect that may be being used right now primarily by the United States, but that's not going to stay true. That's going to change quite rapidly, and they will soon be used by many other actors. So I think of the U.S., for better or worse, as sort of on the vanguard here. But we're going to be seeing a lot more of this from other actors as well. So I want to talk today mostly about the U.S. war on terrorism, but also about two other, and specifically about drones a little bit more, but also about two other trends that we're seeing the beginnings of now, but I think we're going to see a whole lot more of in the future. And the future, by the future, I don't mean 50 years out, I mean even 10 years out. And one of those trends is what you could call the individualization of warfare or the personalization of warfare. And the other has to do with the emergence of various nonviolent forms of warfare, non-lethal weapons, cyber, et cetera, and the impact that those have and will have on our ability to regulate the violence of state actors. And big open question, which was raised by someone yesterday, what about all the non-state actors? Good question, bracket that for now. So for now, focusing on states. So these new kinds of warfare challenge both our understanding of what war is, because they are, in the case of drone strikes and other individualized forms of warfare, they are not widespread necessarily. In the case of non-lethal weapons, they are not even violent. And they increasingly also challenge our ability to apply the legal framework we have in a way that is consistent and principled and helps us achieve what I think our normative goals should be, which is ensuring that we continue to live, insofar as we do live, in a rule of law society in which the power of states is exercised in account, can only be exercised accountably. Okay, so let's talk first about drones and the US war on terror. Obviously, already confounds any understanding of what war is, because when you're talking about an armed conflict with a transnational non-state actor, any traditional assumptions about wars between two states, or even a state and an insurgent group, or multiple states, gosh, how do you have a war when the enemy is multiple individuals not affiliated with the militaries of any states, and they have multiple nationalities, and they operate from multiple different states, which may or may not be aware of their presence and may or may not approve of it, and they are highly mobile and perfectly happy to recruit new people from still other states as soon as you think you have a handle on them. Add to that a set of actors that changes frequently, that is not hierarchically organized necessarily, it may be, but isn't necessarily hierarchically organized, that operates almost entirely covertly most of the time, such that you can't necessarily initiate peace negotiations because you can't find them and they don't particularly want to talk to you anyway. So that already confounds our ability to draw our comfortable boundaries around armed conflict. But I want to talk specifically about drone strikes. And I want to come back. It's possible some of you are thinking in the back of your minds, well, wait a minute, the US calls that a war on terror, but it's not a war. They're just wrong. It's something else. It's international policing or something else, so they're just wrong to call it a war. I want to come back to that in a minute, to that question of legality and our ability to assess legality and our ability to figure out how legally we should even categorize some of these things in a moment. But let me talk specifically about U.S. drone strikes, which in the last 6 or 7 years have become particularly controversial and have generated a great deal of media attention. So let me start with what we sort of think we know. What we sort of think we know, and I say this not based on knowledge gained while working for the U.S. government, but just on what's out there in the realm of media and NGOs. I have to say that, by the way, otherwise the Defense Department gets really mad at me. So I speak not based on any knowledge gleaned on the inside of the U.S. government. But what we think we know, not because the U.S. government has publicly released any of this information, but because of the good work of journalists and non-governmental organizations, is that the U.S. has used drones, these unmanned aerial vehicles, to outside of so-called hot battlefields or traditional battlefields. Again, the traditional battlefield, Afghanistan in 2009, traditional battlefield, Iraq 2006, traditional battlefield, lots of people in uniform, fighting each other, open, everybody acknowledges who the parties are. you may not have specific details about, say, a specific U.S. raid, but if you go to the U.S. government, say, U.S. government, are you at war with anybody in Iraq right now? The U.S. government will say, yes, in fact, we are. And we have 150,000 troops there, and they're at war with these other parties, and here are our aims, and so on. So the traditional battlefield, geographically bounded, et cetera, we know who the parties are. But beginning in 2002, occurring sporadically for the next few years, and then accelerating quite dramatically after 2009, the U.S. has been using drones to kill particular individuals outside of these traditional battlefields. And we know that the U.S. has conducted somewhere between maybe 300 and 500 or 600 drone strikes. We know that they've occurred certainly in Pakistan, in Yemen, in Somalia. Newspaper reports indicate, I also have to say that, and I say this too because I just had a book manuscript go through the Defense Department's pre-publication security review, and it came back to me with a lot of black lines through things. So I will tell you that the New York Times has reported that the U.S. has also used drone strikes against ISIS suspects in Libya, against various people in Syria, possibly in the Philippines, possibly in Mali, et cetera. We also, our best guess from NGO and journalistic reporting is that these strikes have collectively over the course of 7 or 8 years killed probably 4,000 or 5,000 people. It's a lot of people. A lot of dead people, not as many dead people as are piling up in Syria, but it's still, that's not a negligible number of dead bodies, right? And I keep saying, of course, what we know, and this is reported and so forth, because this is all done in secret. If you ask the United States to this day, although this is very poorly kept secret, if you ask representatives of the U.S. government whether the United States government carries out targeted strikes in these states, the answer will continue to be today what it has been for the last 8 years, which is we can neither confirm nor deny the existence of any such program. So they kind of talk around it a little bit and will say things like, well, it is very sad that somebody dropped a missile on somebody over there and it seemed to have hit some of the wrong people, but we can't confirm or deny that that was us, and so on and so forth. So this remains cloaked in this sort of strange cloak of secret but not secret war. That makes it very, very hard for us to really conclude much of anything, right, definitively. We're pretty sure it's happening, right, that it's not that easy to hide piles of dead bodies and destroyed buildings and so forth that journalists and NGOs and people's relatives tend to notice. So we know that something is happening. We basically know that it's pretty much only the United States that's had the capability to do these things. But when you push U.S. government representatives on this, they deny it, but then they say, well, if we were doing it, which we didn't say that we were, but if we were, what's your objection? You can't possibly have an objection because it is known to all that we are in an armed conflict with Al-Qaeda and its associated forces. And it happens that those associated forces keep morphing and changing and evolving, and they now apparently include ISIS, even though ISIS and Al-Qaeda are fighting each other, but that doesn't matter because ISIS is descended from Al-Qaeda in various ways, so we're going to consider it all part of the same morphing, shape-shifting terrorist threat with which we are in an armed conflict, and as is well known, during an armed conflict, it is lawful to target enemy combatants. And we, the United States, are deeply committed to complying with the laws of armed conflict, and therefore you can rest assured that were we to be targeting anybody through any means, whether drone strikes or anything else, we are only targeting those who are enemy combatants in our armed conflict with Al-Qaeda, et cetera, et cetera. And there's just no issue here. And why are you getting so upset? And you kind of, people sort of get upset anyway. And then the U.S. government says, you know, not unreasonably, sort of says, well, what's the problem? You know, wars kill people. And it's true, they say perhaps these strikes that we may or may not have carried out from time to time do kill civilians, which is very sad if it happens, but wars do kill civilians. And it's not illegal to kill civilians by accident, provided that you take appropriate care and so forth. It happens. And nobody got too mad at us for the fact that we killed Iraqi soldiers and Taliban soldiers and sometimes Iraqi and Afghan civilians in these armed conflicts, because that's what happens in war. You may think the wars were unnecessary. You may think we could have used different tactics, but there's nothing illegal here, and there's nothing new here with these targeted drone strikes. There's nothing new here at all, because it's just the same thing. You know, lawful wartime targeting of enemy combatants. Go away. So is this lawful? Anybody, just out of curiosity, I know probably most of you are not lawyers, but when you think about U.S. drone strikes, how many of you would be inclined to say, wait a minute, these are illegal? Raise your hand if you'd be inclined to say these are illegal. All right, so about half of you, or more than, maybe more than half, a little more than half, perhaps. Well, that would be nice to be able to say it was illegal, but I think it's more complicated than that. I've been a vociferous critic of U.S. drone strikes for all kinds of reasons, but I actually think that the U.S. is not clearly legally incorrect. I don't think they're clearly legally correct either to say, hey, what's the problem here? I think, and because we're in Vienna, I'm going to have to show one quick visual aid. Does everybody knows what this is? Okay, this is in honor of famous Viennese citizen Ludwig Wittgenstein. This is his famous duck rabbit, which, depending on how you look at it, is either obviously and manifestly a duck or obviously and manifestly a rabbit. And Wittgenstein's point, as I think you all know, is that it doesn't mean anything to say, clearly it's a duck or clearly it's a rabbit. You can be right and wrong at the same time. That it gets its meaning through context, it gets its meaning through what is around it. That if you put this picture in a field surrounded by pictures of what are clearly ducks, you say, oh, clearly it's a duck. You put it around rabbits, so it's a rabbit, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that we have reached a point in which the categories that our ability to apply the law of armed conflict depend upon have become so destabilized that we no longer have any, that when we say, oh, U.S. drone strikes are illegal or they're legal, it's essentially saying, oh, it's clearly a duck, oh, it's clearly a rabbit. I can make a very compelling legal argument to you about which would make my friends in the U.S. Justice Department very happy about why this is lawful. And those are, you know, they're decent people, they're serious people, they don't think they're lying, you know, they think they're doing their best, they think that they are deeply committed to the rule of law and to compliance with the law of armed conflict, applicable U.S. law, human rights law, you name it, they're absolutely convinced of that. And I can also make an argument about why this is utterly illegal. And as I said earlier and yesterday, boy, this really matters, right? Because it's pretty problematic to have a situation in which a very powerful state has killed several thousand people over a series of years in nations with which it is not at war in any traditional sense, secretly, based on secret evidence in a secret process, that is not even acknowledged later based on secret criteria, et cetera. And we can't definitively say, is it lawful or not? Because we can't agree on some very, very basic concepts. And I've sat in so many rooms over the last decade with very, very smart lawyers from the United States, from human rights NGOs and humanitarian law NGOs, and from various countries other than the United States, and argued in circles about these issues. And it always just goes in circles, because the US lawyers say, what's the problem? Armed conflict, lawful target enemy combatants. And various NGO lawyers say, but it's not an armed conflict. And the US says, well, why not? Why can't it be an armed? And they say, well, because it's just not. You know, it's just not. It just doesn't look exactly like one. And the US says, well, wait a second, you know, Al-Qaeda killed as many people on 9/11. They killed more people than the Japanese killed when they bombed Pearl Harbor. You're telling us that we can't count that as an armed conflict, you know, or we can't, or just because this combatant in Al-Qaeda and its associates goes over here, that we can't target them anymore just because they're not standing over there? That doesn't make any sense. And they're they're both right, right? I don't actually think there is a definitive legal answer to this question, which doesn't mean that there shouldn't be an answer to this question and doesn't mean that the practice is therefore okay, but does mean, I think, that if you look to the law to give you an answer, you're going to look in vain. It's not going to give you an answer that everyone can agree on. And that is different from other legal problems. You know, it's always, of course, true that, you know, you put two lawyers in a room and they can argue different sides of an issue. But I think, and I say this as someone who spends a lot of my time grading the examination papers of hundreds of young law students, there's usually a better and a worse answer, and it's usually pretty clear. And usually you get 10 lawyers in a room and you say, what's the better and the worst legal answer here? And they say, yeah, 9 of them say it's this. But this is a situation where you just go around in circles forever. The determinations of legality on U.S. drone strikes actually only get more difficult and complicated when you throw in what the U.S. usually does throw in, which is a little dollop, not just from the law of armed conflict, but a little dollop from the international law and the use of force and self-defense. And they tend to kind of smush them together in ways that make international lawyers crazy. And sort of saying, well, okay, not only is it an armed conflict, and these are enemy combatants in an armed conflict, but on top of that, everybody knows that all states have the right to use force in self-defense. And yes, it is true that the attack was kind of a while ago, but on the other hand, you can, you know, traditionally use force to stave off an imminent attack. And there's a, for any of you who are particularly fond of Orwellian legal formulations, I'd urge you to take a look at a memo that was leaked about a year or two ago. It was a 2011 memo, U.S. Justice Department memo on targeting of U.S. citizens. And it said, well, it is true that the traditional legal standard for using force in self-defense is to ward off an imminent attack. And we need to, however, rethink what imminence means. And this, those of you who recall the Bush administration's preemptive self-defense doctrine, this actually takes it several steps further by saying, well, here's the problem with terrorists. Problem with terrorists is that we don't know what they're doing. We don't know what they're planning to do. That's kind of by definition, we don't know what they're planning to do. But we know that they're planning to do us harm given the opportunity, that they're always planning to do us harm. And normally you'd say you can't use force to ward off an imminent attack if you have no knowledge that there is an imminent attack. You don't know anything about it. But here the argument gets sort of turned on its head. And the idea is expressed in this particular leaked memo, is that because terrorists are presumptively always planning to do harm, that there is always an imminent attack coming, and the fact that you don't have any specific knowledge of the nature, timing, or scale of that attack merely is evidence that they are terrorists and they are hiding their nefarious plans from you, and that therefore bad things are always imminent. So you're always justified in using force. And for those of you who are lawyers, I would note that, among other things, of course, this makes any of the traditional discussions of the necessity or proportionality of force to ward off that imminent attack literally impossible, because if you don't know the nature or scale of an imminent attack, there's no possible way to evaluate what's proportional to an attack of an unknown type and scale. You just can't do it. So that's just another piece of this puzzle. And on the one hand, I actually think that, you know, if you're 9 out of 10 lawyers at that point say, whoa, wait a minute, you just lost us there. But nevertheless, it's not completely crazy for the U.S. to say, this is a different kind of threat. You know, you don't see the massed armies assembling on your border, but that doesn't mean that there isn't a threat. You know, that they're not wrong to say that, even though I think the legal logic gets you to a place that nobody should want to get to. So this is not a good situation. It's not a good situation for all kinds of reasons. I think, among other things, it's not doing the U.S. any good strategically. I think the old question that Donald Rumsfeld, the former Secretary of Defense under George W. Bush, is said to have asked of the Iraq war, are we killing terrorists faster than we create new ones, can be asked about U.S. targeted drone strikes as well. But it's also not a good situation because of the precedents it sets. I think yesterday we mentioned the death of Alexander Litvinenko through radiation poisoning in London. I remember, and Katha, I'm sure you remember, 1976 murder of Orlando Letelier and Ronnie Moffitt in Washington, D.C. by agents of the Chilean government, the Pinochet regime. We have long lived in the world in which we think that when a foreign state uses force covertly inside another state to murder someone they deem an enemy, we call those assassinations and we say they're unlawful and we don't like them. And needless to say, the US targeted strikes very much blur that line between are these lawful wartime killings or are they just murders? Are they assassinations of the type that the US, as well as most other states, have long condemned and should condemn? I think that the US, not only the strikes, but the legal logic, the legal argumentation behind justification for these targeted strikes, is also dangerous in some more pernicious kinds of ways. It reduces our, because it's covert, because it's all done covertly, and because the category questions at the very beginning of, well, what's a war, what's how do we know what a war is? Does this count? Does this count? Does this count? How do we know who's a combatant? Does this group count? Does that group count? Does this person count? Does that person count? Because there is so little consensus internationally on how to apply those categories and therefore what set of rules should apply and therefore whether these practices are lawful or not lawful, it reduces the ability to predict how and when states will use force by undermining any sort of shared consensus on the meaning of the terms that are so crucial to applying the law. And I also think, and this is an issue I'll return to in a moment, that the availability, I'm always arguing with people who say, aha, the problem here is drones. We should just ban drones. And I would say, well, that's not really getting at the issue. You know, it's just an airplane without a person in it. You know, there's nothing particularly sinister and evil about it. But what it does do, and that's certainly true, and it actually probably causes fewer civilian deaths than manned aircraft. Drone pilots have a much clearer sense of what they're doing than a bomber flying at 30,000 feet. But that being said, because these unmanned aerial vehicles do not pose any immediate risk to the military personnel of the nation or power that uses them, and because, ironically, they are correctly perceived as being less likely to cause unintended civilian casualties, I think it lowers the threshold for using force. You know, that if you're a political leader or a military leader and you have to make a decision about using force in an armed conflict or self-defense situation, if you think that your use of force is going to kill a large number of your own personnel and potentially kill a large number of innocent civilians, you could probably, we hope at least, that you're going to think really hard about that decision to use force. On the other hand, if you have this technology that enables you to use force across borders with no risk to your own troops, and you think no risk to the innocent, however you have chosen to define them, you may be more willing to make those decisions with greater frequency and less thought. And I think, in fact, we've seen that happen with U.S. drone strikes, which went over a relatively short period of time from rare and exceptional to a standard tool in the US foreign policy arsenal, if you will. I also think that there, from the perspective of rule of law and democratic accountability, as an American citizen, I am stunned and shocked, and I have trouble making some of my friends at the Justice Department understand this, by the fact that my government is waging a secret war, which it will not acknowledge. That I find it just stunning and shocking that today a powerful state can kill thousands of people without even having to acknowledge it, much less come forward and justify it. And I think that that's from the perspective of an American citizen, that's a problem in terms of the accountability of my government to myself and other taxpayers and citizens. But I also think from a global human rights perspective, we now have a situation. And getting away for a minute from all those, we lawyers get, we get so wrapped up in these questions about legality, of course, but getting away from that for a minute and going just back to really basic assumptions about rights and the rule of law, we have a situation where a powerful state kills people around the globe and doesn't even admit it, much less have any process for externally saying, well, should that person have been killed or not? You know, and again, so go back to that original set of questions about the behaviors we tolerate and the constraints we think should or don't need to exist in the context of armed conflict versus peacetime. The more you put in that war box, the more you're willing to accept as being part of war on the other side of the line that separates war from not war, the more you're willing to accept a situation in which powerful actors can kill without any accountability whatsoever or any mechanism for accountability whatsoever. And again, my friends at the Justice Department in the US say, but what's the difference between this and traditional wars? You know that when the Allied forces invaded, the invasion of Normandy, nobody expected that we were going to tell you exactly the names of which Germans we killed and explain exactly, we say, oh, well, that guy, we had to shoot him because he was coming over here and he was waving his machine gun at me, so I had, you know, everybody accepts that when there's an armed conflict, of course you don't do that, it's ridiculous. And yet we have these practices that are further and further away from what looks like traditional armed conflicts, but are continuing to apply rules that make some amount of sense when we have an exceptional and bounded state of affairs, but make less and less sense when the ability to distinguish between war and ordinary life goes away. But as I said, it's not just US policy and it's not just drones. Talk briefly about two other trends, both of which further challenge our collective ability to draw any coherent line between war and not war, and between permissible state uses of coercion and control and impermissible uses. One is the trend towards greater and greater individualization of warfare, and we do see this already with drones, and there's a particularly, my old professor, who's my human rights law professor when I was in law school many years ago, was Harold Coe. And Harold, who was a very good professor, a very good friend, a mentor, became the dean of Yale Law School and then went on to become the legal advisor to the United States Department of State and became intimately involved in these legal decisions about the lawfulness of targeted killings. And Harold said in a speech a couple of years back, he said, and this was in the context of offering legal justification and showing how much care was taken by the US government before choosing who to strike. And he said, you know, when I was the dean of Yale Law School and a professor at Yale Law School, I would look at the admissions applications for dozens and dozens of young people in the early 20s, and I would see their picture, and I'd see their CV, and I would read about their families and their interests and their education to decide whether to admit them to Yale Law School. And he said, now I look at very similar dossiers on young men, mostly young men, with their pictures and their CVs, and it's to decide whether or not we should kill them. But think again how different this is from earlier conflicts. I was looking at an old photograph that came from my great-grandmother, my mother's grandmother. And it was a photograph of a group of young Canadian soldiers on the eve of World War I. And on the back, it was about six or eight soldiers, and on the back it had a list of their names, and one of them was my great-grandmother's cousin, and it said, you know, shot with a machine gun. And I was still looking at this picture and thinking how different that kind of war was from today, you know, that my great-grandmother knew a lot about this guy who was shot with a machine gun. I did some quick internet research. I learned a lot about him. It's quite amazing what you can find out. I learned his weight and his chest measurements upon his enlistment in the Army. I learned the names of his siblings, where he went to college. I knew a lot about him. My great-grandmother, who presumably loved him, knew a whole lot more. But the German who shot him with a machine gun outside of Ypres did not know anything about him except that he was some guy and he was there. You know, nothing personal about that form of warfare. Contrast that with these drone strikes where dossiers on those who will be killed are assembled weeks or years in advance. We literally, We know that the dossiers may reportedly include information on their families, their habits. Drone pilots may watch them for weeks or months, looking at their patterns of life, seeing them playing with their children, talking to their friends, and so on. We may know an enormous amount about these people. And we're not just saying, let's kill the enemy. We're saying, let's kill that 24-year-old in Yemen who is related to these people and lives here and did this and so on. Now in some ways, this is a good thing, right? Because I sometimes say to people, if you don't like the concept of targeted killing, how do you feel about untargeted killing? In some ways, we should presumably be applauding this and saying, well, that's good. Isn't it a better world if only the bad guys are targeted? And we don't have to accept a world in which, you know, we're firebombing Dresden or dropping an atomic bomb on Hiroshima. This is better. This is better. So on some level, say, yeah, this is something to applaud. Far, far better than the kind of indiscriminate slaughter that characterized so many past wars and still so many current wars. But again, bad news. It seems to utterly erode any ability to draw a line between murder and wartime. But add in the around-the-corner technologies. I'm sure you've all played with your Apple Mac face recognition technology when you go through your own photo albums and it says, oh, is this a photo of Shalini? Oh, yes, it is. Amazing. It's amazing. It found a picture of you from 15 years ago and it still figured out who you were. You know, the off-the-shelf consumer technologies for facial recognition and voice recognition are now astonishing. And assume that governments have even better ones. Imagine not only our existing surveillance and reconnaissance technologies, but imagine, for instance, a swarm of miniaturized drones with facial recognition software that can fly over a crowd at a protest and pick a particular face out of a crowd and target that person with a precision weapon that will kill them but nobody else. Imagine, I said earlier, bioweapons. You are probably all aware, and some of you may know far more than I know about the potentially revolutionary impact of personalized medicine that is linked to particular genetic vulnerabilities. That the hope is in the very near future, we'll be able to have medicines and medical interventions that aren't just thrown at you in the vague hope that it'll push your cancer into remission, but that are targeted to your specific genetic code and that we know will go after your cancer and cure you. Trouble is that this very same prospect of personalized medicine also opens up the prospect of personalized afflictions. Those same insights into the genome will certainly enable both states and potentially non-state actors to create genetically targeted weapons that may not be individualized, that may be aimed, for instance, at entire ethnic groups with similar genetic markings, or may be designed just to target, say, a particular leader. It's already known that a number of states, my own included, but not only the United States, are collecting DNA samples from world leaders. You visit the White House and clip a couple hairs, lend you a hairbrush and say, can I have that hairbrush back? And we got your DNA code. Not because, in the case of the United States, I think they're actively developing these weapons, but more defensively out of fear that these weapons will be developed by others, but we'll see an arms race in that direction. But so again, you can imagine this individualization that we already see with U.S. targeted strikes being taken several steps further and being used not just by the U.S., but by other powerful states and potentially by non-state actors as well, particularly when you're looking as the trends in both drones and robotics and in bioengineering, everything is getting smaller, everything is getting cheaper, everything is getting easier for individuals and relatively small groups to use rather than just states, so further eroding any state monopoly on the use of these technologies. The other trend, which I mentioned briefly yesterday, is the development of non-lethal technologies, which, again, isn't that great? Wouldn't it be great if you could have a war and nobody would get killed? Yes, that would be better than having a war in which thousands and thousands of people get killed. But imagine some of these bioweapons aren't designed to kill, but are rather designed to disable or cause cognitive degradation, hallucinations, the inability to concentrate. Imagine that they targeted specific political leaders. I suspect maybe they already have, but based on some of the, maybe Donald Trump is the victim of a bioweapon. That would explain a lot. Or imagine, and this already exists, laser weapons that are designed to paralyze or cause paralyzing pain without causing any lasting physical damage. And the U.S. actually already has these. They wanted to use them, but there was just enough of an outcry. They kind of said, okay, fine, we'll just keep them on the shelf. I forget the name of it, but it's a radio frequency device that causes a sensation of burning. So the utility of this is fairly obvious. Let's say you're a guard at a U.S. forward operating base in Afghanistan, and three young men walk towards you, and they're carrying something in your hands, and you can't see them, and you say, stop, don't come any closer, and they don't pay any attention. You don't know. Are they suicide bombers, or are they just a bunch of guys who don't speak English, and they didn't understand what you said, and you'd be slaughtering some totally innocent people if you shot them? Well, wouldn't it be nice to be able to aim your little radio frequency device at them, and they go, ow, and they stop, and they don't come any closer, but they're not hurt. They're fine. You take your hand off the button, and they all get up again, and everybody goes home, and everybody's still alive. Isn't that nice? You know, and it is on some level, right? But it's part of a trend that we've already seen towards conflict that causes less death over the last 50 years or so. So the bad news is less death and less indiscriminate death and suffering. That's the good news. The bad news is, and I think you can probably figure this out for yourselves, the Orwellian possibilities are quite terrifying. As with drones, when you lower the perceived costs of using force, when you have technologies that enable the powerful states and others to kill or otherwise coerce and control without assuming much risk, either to their own forces or to others, no dead bodies at the end of the day, they're going to use them, they're going to use them more, and they're going to use them more carelessly. And the potential for more totalitarian kinds of uses of these technologies, because they seem like an advance, because they're an improvement, is, I think, quite frightening. Needless to say, this further confounds, as if the future unfolds as I think it very likely will, this will further confound any ability to say what's war and what's not war. And I remember the old 60s query, rhetorical query, you know, what if they gave a war and no one came? And I think we may know the answer to that now, which is that war would carry on quite happily, because you won't need mass armies anymore. You won't need piles of dead body anymore. That increasingly, actors will be able to achieve the political ends that Clausewitz assumes you needed war to achieve without having to use what we traditionally think of as war. You'll be able to assert control and dominance over both individuals and whole populations in ways that are virtually invisible and potentially deniable, and in ways that are individualized and targeted, and in ways that don't leave anybody lying dead on the battlefield at the end of the day. Doesn't look like a war. Whether we choose to, if we choose to put these things, and cyber would come into the same, be a similar type of issue in terms of its both ability to be individualized and non-lethal. If we choose to put these into the category we call war, and govern the use of these technologies through a framework designed to control the exceptional, temporary, bounded armed conflicts that we traditionally think about, then we're creating a future in which these technologies and their use will be constrained only quite minimally. If we choose to put them in some other box or to change the legal frameworks altogether and to change the categories we use to make sense of these types of exercises of power, then maybe we can have a somewhat different future. But I think the path we're on right now and the trend that we have seen in terms of how, certainly in the United States, these have been defined and these have been defined and legally justified, which we've seen Vladimir Putin quite happily pick up on. So I think we can expect other powerful states to say, hey, this works pretty well for me. I think we can expect the future that looks fairly bleak. But that's all for now. Final lecture, implications, and what, if anything, can we do about this?
Thank you. Rosa, sorry, this is this ended today on a bleak note. I hope on Thursday we're going to have a little more optimism from you.
But only a little.
But a little. But because I think you're going to talk very much more also about the legal implications of some of these things in the next lecture. Today we've been walked through by you with a lot of, we're confronted with a lot of the new technologies of warfare. But also I think what you show is really the intractability of some of these issues and the impossibility in a way of finding easy solutions. And I think that's a perspective which opens up a whole new set of questions. And I'd like to open the floor and give it to Gabor to begin with.
Thank you very much.
Constitutional lawyer, Rosa.
Yeah, and unfortunately, I won't be able to hear next the final lecture. So that is why probably my question is a little bit broad. I enjoyed very much your both of your presentations, but my conclusion so far that I'm afraid that the U.S. legal system, as it stands, how to put it, is an unfit subject of your investigation, both internally, I mean, regarding the national judicial review process, and also internationally, because you mentioned already regarding the internal issue that there is no oversight. So what we are talking about, if there is no oversight about drone strikes, so who decides whether it's legal or not legal? So your question whether it's legal or not legal, I cannot answer your question because there is no answer to that question in the US. And there is no answer to that question internationally, since the US do not join international treaties. First of all, the international...
The US is party to most of the treaties that relate to these issues.
Except the ICC. Which means that there is no accountability. So what we are talking about, the U.S. can define whatever they want, and there will be no accountability, neither internally nor externally. Mm-hmm. Being a little bit more precise, internally, I'm not an expert in international law, but I realize that the trick in within the U.S. and Harold Coe was instrumental to this, playing with the extraterritorial application of the U.S. law. About the international law, it's really, and this goes back to yesterday's lecture. I was wondering, and Jeffrey Sachs was here last week, and he raised the question of the war in Syria and also in Libya. And taking into consideration also the New York Times pieces about Hillary Clinton's efforts. So my question, for instance, is it a war when the US actually goes into those kind of negotiations with opposition leaders in Libya? And probably the same can be told about Syria. So this goes back to the very question, what is war? Is the US part of the war in Libya, or was part of the war in Libya, and is part of the war in Syria?
You know, so that there's a really interesting question, right? So I take a more anthropological approach to law. I'm not terribly formalist about it. And to me, the question about legality on some level is, as you suggest, law is what enough authoritative people say it is sufficient to engender compliance, right? And whether the authoritative people sit on a court or whether the authoritative people are within a national government or just a body of public opinion, if it induces compliance with that particular legal interpretation, then it's right, it's the law, right? And one of the things that's been really interesting and depressing to me, and this will be a challenge to you European lawyers and citizens, is that while almost every European lawyer, international law expert I've spoken to has taken the position that the US is miscategorizing as armed conflict something that doesn't count, what has not happened is European states saying that consistently and clearly to the US government. What has not happened is European states saying, we actually believe that you are committing criminal acts under international law, and therefore we will not share intelligence with you, for instance, that would enable you to conduct these targeted strikes, many of which do depend on intelligence provided by allies. There has been no pushback, virtually no pushback outside of academic journals and the media in Europe. So the US government is not feeling, if you talk to, again, you talk to my dear friends at the Justice Department at the White House and you say to them, but the Europeans disagree with your legal interpretation. They say, well, they're not telling us that. They're still giving us intelligence. They're still working with us. They're still being part of coalitions with us. And think about what happens, again, to settled legal interpretations when, you know, international law is still made by states, which doesn't mean that states are the only actors that influence it, but when one powerful state, probably the most powerful state, the United States, advances a theory of the case that is different or shocking or may seem unlawful or may simply seem like, well, maybe it's not manifestly unlawful, but it leads to horrible outcomes, we don't like it. And other states don't challenge it. You know, when other states just keep, you know, and other states have a choice, right? They can challenge it and denounce it, they can agree with it, or they can stay silent. And when they just stay silent, what tends to happen over time, when they stay silent and the Vladimir Putins of the world say, hey, I kind of agree with that, that's not bad. You know, I've got some enemy combatants I'd kind of like to go after too. Thank you, US, for offering me a script. You know, that's the law, it's not static. It's going to change. It's going to change in ways that we may hate.
Thank you for that. And actually, I'll follow up. Tell if this is, it is on. Follow up on Gabor's question, because I think, you know, this question of the making of law, I mean, at the start of your talk, you said, well, you know, I could get two lawyers in a room and they could argue both sides of the case. But of course, you know, there we're forgetting the question of power, of who actually decides to make the law, as you were just saying. And, you know, I like the fact that you pointed out that there was always, even during the Bush years, the preoccupation with the legality of all of these interventions. And I listened to a talk given by Valerie Plame a couple of years ago, and this is exactly what she noted, this preoccupation, mm-hmm. citing Carl Schmitt, of all people, saying we need to make the law in a way that suits our purposes, but nonetheless. Going back to this last point about, you know, why is it that European states are not responding? You're absolutely right. Why isn't what has happened with, for example, furnishing drugs to administer lethal injections for the death penalty happening in this case? I mean, there are ways to do it. But my question actually regarded the second part of your talk, thinking about these new technologies and how they're changing the borders of war. Because, you know, if one of the things that is happening is kind of disruption between the notion of internal and external security and securing, and even the slippage between internal policing functions in states and external war waging functions. What are the dangers, you know, that you were, I think, hinting at? You were talking about the Orwellian dangers of some of these technologies being used against states' own populations, and I'm not just referring to the United States. I mean, I think there's, you know, kind of another slippage there of, you know, war breaking its boundaries. That's not only being used for targeted killings elsewhere, but
sure. No, I think that's absolutely right, and legally, and in terms of practices, I think certainly in the United States and certainly in the UK and France, and I'm less familiar with other cases, we're already seeing a kind of a trickle down of both legal practices and policies that were designed for or initiated in the context of counterterrorism and the war against terrorism that are finding their way into ordinary process. And in the US, for instance, we see this very clearly in the militarization of the police. Little known fact, you may be aware that there's been enormous controversy in New York City about so-called stop and frisk, where police stop people and just pat them down, see if they have weapons or drugs, controversy stems from the fact that the very large, disproportionate majority of those stopped and frisked are African Americans, although in fact the disproportionate majority of those found who have weapons or drugs tend to be white. The stop and frisk was introduced within the New York City police as a result of the former police commissioner taking a trip to Israel, where the Israelis explained that they found this a terrifically useful tactic for finding Palestinian terrorists. And it was brought back to the United States and introduced in the context of domestic criminal policing. We see it in US immigration and refugee policy, which has become also tremendously militarized, and both practices and legal frameworks very much influenced by the same set of counterterrorism concerns. But we also see it in some ways even more in a We see it seeping into ordinary legal process in civil cases, for instance, and an example, I have a colleague at Georgetown who's done some fantastic research on the use of the so-called state secrets doctrine. State secrets doctrine, the executive branch, let's say there is a case case involving a CIA employee who alleges workplace harassment and threatens to reveal the existence of a classified program, that the US government can come in and say, court, your honor, if you permit this evidence to be put forward, it would damage US national security, so you either need to suppress this evidence or dismiss the case altogether. So we've seen that, but not just in the context of cases that directly link to national security. It's begun to sort of trickle down into ordinary tort law litigation, civil litigation, because as the sort of security state has grown and more private corporations have developed links to the US government, for instance, telecommunications companies being part of surveillance plans. What that can then mean is you, an ordinary consumer, go to sue your internet provider over a service problem, and your internet provider calls up the Justice Department and says, oh, for various reasons, in order to defend ourselves from this claim about bad service, we're going to have to reveal our cooperation with you on this program that you don't want to be revealed. We'd like you to come in and intervene and say state secrets, and the case will be dismissed. And that has been happening more and more. So in areas further and further removed from obvious connections to a war, we're seeing a kind of a trickle-down impact which has diminished government transparency, removed accountability mechanisms, normalized in US courts both the suppression of evidence and increasingly secret ex parte hearings where only one party is permitted to see evidence, et cetera. And, you know, I know less about other systems, but I think that absolutely we should be concerned both about the legal doctrines and about the technologies that enable surveillance and control. Leeching from them, the foreigners, or bad people in bad places, right into the heart of every state in the world.
Thank you very much. I also greatly enjoyed both of your lectures. And I have two questions. Much have been said about the danger of this blurring of lines between war and peace norms, which can lead to the limiting of civil rights, human rights, expansion of state violence, and so on. But is it possible that these blurrings may also lead to the opposite effect? If we cannot tell the difference between war and peace, can we apply those norms which are for peacetime to the war itself? Because all these technologies which you described in detail actually allow us to do this, making wars without killing people, without even damaging them in any way. So it's the first question. Can it lead, or what should we do to make it turn that way? And the second question will be a little bit provocative, because all this development of technologies which enable to make wars without violence, it seems to me that it's a logical development of what Michel Foucault called biopower, which is the power oriented on preservance of people's lives rather than destroyance. Mm-hmm. And as he wrote, this biopower is in unlike repressive power, it operates with normalization rather than prohibition. So biopower operates through normalization of things. And in much of the cases which you mentioned, the question, it's very hard to answer the question whether it is legal or not, whether it is prohibited or not, but rather the question is posed is rather it is more or less appropriate, and that is what is decided. And also the very definitions of what is war are no longer in the domain of international, not all wars, but some of them, not long in the domain of international law, but rather in some media discourse, because such concepts like war on terrorism, they are to a very big extent a populist cliches which justifies some state actions to the own population, to international population, to civil society, whatever. So they rather operate within the public sphere and through the media. And the provocative question is whether it is possible at all to address this problem in the legal discourse which was developed in this framework of repressive power, and can it solve this problem at all? Or probably we can rearticulate legal discourse in the more normalizing way, or maybe there are some other places where can we find this solution to this problem.
I don't want to answer your questions because then I'll have nothing left to say on Thursday. but they're great questions, and I the very, very short answers I think are to your second question is no, it can't be just addressed through the legal discourse. I think the legal discourse has been part of the problem. It's gotten us so far away from the normative discussion of how do we feel about the world that is taking shape as a result of this particular legal discourse, because if we don't like that, the solution is not going to lie from within that discourse. It's going to have to come from outside of it. But your other question of is there the potential, if not to so much, militarize the non-military and warify the non-war, but rather to do the opposite and say, hey, in this blurrier area, isn't this an opportunity then to apply some of our peacetime assumptions about due process and so forth to war? I think the answer to that is absolutely yes. This is, to some extent, going to be the subject of the final lecture, what do we do about this? Are there opportunities here as well as real dangers? And how can we both shift our framework for thinking about this to see some of those opportunities? And I think, by the way, that ultimately the solution won't lie in successfully just saying, oh, that's not war. I think the solution's going to lie elsewhere, and the solution is likely to lie more in saying, okay, we've got this big blurry area, and that blur is real, and it's not going to go away. But how do we, going back to first principles, how do we think about what values we want to protect in that blurry area, and how do we do that and just get away from this overly rigid, well, either it's a war, in which case you got this rules, or it's not, in which case you have this rules. You know, because the threats that states worry about are real too, obviously. You know, that they're not just making this up. I mean, they're sort of making up some stuff. But they're not just making stuff up. So thinking about, okay, states may need to have certain powers that we traditionally don't think they need to have, because there are people out there who are trying to cause harm and mayhem using technologies that states may not have the legal tools to address adequately in the peacetime framework. So, okay, that's fine. But then how do we do that in a way that doesn't involve, you know, throwing basic rights, including the right to life, out the window right along with those legal restrictions?
That was a great talk, Rosa. I'm really sorry we won't be able to hear the last, find out what the end of the story is. So, my question is, do you think there's anything to be said for the view that some of these people that we have assassinated or killed or murdered should have been brought to a regular trial? For example, Osama bin Laden and Anwar al-Awlaki. It just seems to me that to automatically kill these people is a very bad statement for our nation to be making, especially with the second one, because it wasn't like he was killing anybody. He was a person who encouraged other people to kill people, I think, Awlaki. And by killing him, isn't that sort of to say, well, if you say the wrong thing, if you're a propagandist on the other side, then we're going to murder you?
So I think Awlaki did do more than just say, hey, everybody, come join the jihad. You know, he was more actively involved in planning. But I do still think Osama bin Laden is the easiest case, in a sense, sort of, if anybody is a combatant in an armed conflict between the U.S. and al-Qaeda, surely it's Osama bin Laden, right? So in some ways, he's the easiest case, and there, I think, on the sort of fact-based determination of, you know, was it feasible to capture him? Was that possible without excessive risk to others? You know, I think that's an easier one to say, okay, if any strike, and that was a targeted strike, not by a drone, but using special operations forces, if any of them were justified, I think that's the easiest to justify in a traditional framework. I think Anwar al-Awlaki and his 16-year-old son, who was killed shortly thereafter, not apparently at the target, but somebody who happened to be kind of sitting next to a target. That is much harder, and the problem. And again, this is so here's my personal opinion, not the U.S. government's, obviously. But you can't try these people because there's no evidence. You know, the evidence very free, not always, but very frequently the evidence is not the type that you could possibly use in a court. And that is for a number of reasons. One being that the standard line from the government, which is often true, that it would reveal sources and methods, that if you said, aha, we are charging you with, you know, plotting mass murder, conspiracy to commit mass murder, crimes against humanity, or whatever you want to do in an international court or a domestic court, that in order to even produce the specific evidence, it would be obvious to anyone who knew that person that so-and-so in their camp was a spy, and so-and-so would then be dead. So that's one of the reasons that it's evidence that may seem to the targeters ironclad, but can't be used in court without jeopardizing potentially human lives as well as a future intelligence source. But it's not just that. I mean, also, sometimes the intelligence is pretty squishy. It comes from the Yemeni government, or it comes from, you know, some rival group, or it comes, you know, and it's stuff that, again, in this world where the threshold for using force has been lowered because there's no risk, why not err on the side of, you know, I mean, again, this is our going back to remember that people are applying, they're applying the traditional framework for armed conflicts. And the traditional framework for armed conflict says the degree of evidence that you need if you're there on the battlefield, you know, there you are on this beach at Normandy, you don't have to wait for, you know, beyond a reasonable doubt, that guy coming towards you to show you his German million and pick up his gun to shoot at you. You can engage in what is the legal term is called status-based targeting. You're not targeting people because they have done something bad or you have certainty they're about to do something bad. You get to target them because they're the enemy. And traditionally, you know, you don't care if he's the chef for the German army or if he, you know, you don't care if he's a cook or a special forces expert. You know, he's a German soldier and he is targetable under the law of armed conflict. So the response would be, I think, often it's not feasible because we can't capture without too much risk. B, we couldn't try because the evidence would be either reveal sources and methods or wouldn't be of the type to stand up in court because it's third hand and it's hearsay and it's putting together this and that. And C, you're making a category mistake because we don't need evidence to kill somebody in armed conflict. We only need to know that he's an enemy combatant. Well, how do you know he's an enemy combatant? Oh, because of the evidence. Well, it gets very circular, needless to say. It's completely circular. And the legality problem is compounded by the secrecy. You know, and this is sort of why am I much more troubled by these targeted strikes in outside of traditional battlefields than in them? Well, at least in a traditional battlefield, you know, nobody is disputing, is the U.S. using airstrikes in Syria right now? Yes, we know it is. Was the U.S. using force in Afghanistan today? Yes, we know it is. And when the U.S. When U.S. forces destroyed the Doctors Without Borders hospital, the U.S. said, oh my God, we're investigating. We screwed up. Somebody's going to be punished. And you know, nobody's denying it. So you may not have the perfect level of accountability that you would get in a peacetime setting, but it's not covert. Nobody's saying, hospital, what hospital? U.S. forces, what U.S. forces? Whereas in the context of these strikes, the problem of was there a mistake, was there an abuse, was the evidence sufficient, is just compounded by the, you know, we didn't see a drone strike.
Yeah, last question. Okay. I want to ask you about what Cellini called the intractability of all of this, and go back to the duck rabbit. So,
just so you know, I don't know if you're aware of this, but everybody should be aware of it. There is a duck rabbit brewery in North Carolina in the United States, so you can now buy duck rabbit beer by the case and by the keg. And in fact, my students last year surprised me with an end of the year gift of an enormous amount of duck rabbit beer, which everyone should have.
Right. Well, here's the question. I mean, this is really interesting that you should suggest that this set of issues, the problem of distinguishing between war and not war, which is what you began with and have been illustrating all the way through, that this is, it seems, unique or different from other legal disputes, other things that divide lawyers, where, as you say, that's not the way lawyers or teachers in law schools behave. I mean, you assume, as Ronald Dworkin once said, you can't think that there's no right answer. You have to assume there is a right answer, even if it's really problematic. That's the way you lawyers work, I guess. I'm not a lawyer, but. So here we seem to have a situation where, as you've been illustrating all the way through, there's good news and there's bad news. It seems intractable. But then, so what is your project here? I mean, are we looking for the right answer, or are we just to assume there is no right answer? And if there's no right answer, what then follows from that? Does it then mean that the question is decided by power, by whoever, as it were, is in power, which is, I think, partly what you suggested. But then another thing you suggested when you talked about your anthropological background, well, maybe it's what everybody can be got to agree about. Is that the way we should think about this? Or do you have in your mind the idea that, well, maybe there is a right answer, or that somehow we should try and arrive at something that we could all agree about?
I don't think that existing legal frameworks give us a currently correct legal answer. I also don't think that law is ever divorced either from power or from the collective imagination, the collective understanding of what law means and what it should do. I think, you know, law is created by people. It's people created the Geneva Conventions, people created the UN Charter. They created it in order to achieve specific normative goals. Can you separate out from the fact that those who created the UN Charter and who created the international human rights treaties that most states in the world have signed onto today happened to be largely the victorious powers after World War II? No, you can't separate that out, I know you won't be here on Friday, but these legal creations of the powerful then create new realities that the powerful sometimes lose control of. And think of the Soviets and the Helsinki Accords, for instance, and saying, well, we thought that, you know, we didn't think it was going to make any difference. Well, okay, but guess what? When you sign on to these legal undertakings, it inspires people and it empowers people and it gives people a new set of arguments and a new set of narratives that sometimes end up confounding the very powerful people who thought it would never matter. So I certainly don't think there is some simple answer, but I do think to search for the legal answer right now, I think is a failure of imagination. I think that just as we human beings created the legal framework that we have now, and it arose out of a specific moment in history, out of a specific set of crises and tragedies and abuses, that similarly, it is perfectly possible to imagine both a different framework more suited to the particular set of crises and tragedies we face today, and it is possible to imagine that actually being implemented. Do I think it is likely? Actually, no. I'm very pessimistic. I think we are largely charging down the wrong path, and it would be very difficult to change that. But do I think it's impossible? No. And I think we are suffering from a massive collective failure of imagination globally in terms of being able to sort of say, "Whoa, well, okay, I don't want to. Okay, I'm going to stop because this is what I'm talking about on Friday." But no, I think it is unlikely, but not impossible. That there are different ways to reimagine the legal categories we use and to have those categories be created in order to help us achieve a normative vision of the world.
So thank you, Rosa. I think you've summed up your own talk today. Thanks to many of the questions which were asked, particularly bringing back the question of power into the room, starting, of course, with Gabor's question of, is this possible within the US legal system? To the question of, is it a question of law at all? To the question of, what does it mean if we factor in the exercise of power in the international system into the whole issue of thinking about the future of war. And I look forward to the final lecture on Thursday, so it's day after tomorrow. And I'd like to invite all of you back for a consideration of what the normative answers could mean and if we could go home with a little bit of optimism. But a little bit should be enough, I think, in these times, about whether we can collectively imagine a different legal future and who the we could be, where could these answers come from, who could be actors in a process of initiating a new thinking around really, really, I think, at the moment, an intractable question. So thank you very, very much, and I look forward to the third lecture. Thank you for being with us this evening, and I hope to see you day after tomorrow. And after the lecture day after tomorrow, you'll be invited to a reception with wine and cheese, so please keep the evening free. Thank you so much.